In 2003, the U.S. military coalition forces retook Fallujah, and it was an enemy strong point. It was the historical base for Saddam Hussein, so there was a lot of loyalists that were there. And in 2003, we went in and we took it over, and we secured the city, and we established the entry control points, and we searched every person and every vehicle that came in and out of the city. The problem was that we continued to run into a lot of contraband that was making its way into the city somehow. And that's guns, drugs, money, munitions, everything. It was still making its way into the city. And in 2004, I did a 7-month tour in Africa, and we utilized females as our interpreters, native females as our interpreters, because wherever you go in Africa, you're going to run into 3 or 4 different languages and dialects. And the women, historically, were the ones that went into the villages and did all the trading and the bartering for food. So most of the females in Africa could speak 3 or 4 different languages and dialects. So we started using females in Africa attached to our teams so we could travel freely through the country, and wherever we went, they could speak the language. And the females in Africa really appreciated it, and it was a good duty for them because we treated them very well. And you know, historically, especially in the Muslim areas, the females weren't treated very well. So when I was in Iraq in 2005, and we were having difficulties at controlling the city, one of the main reasons was because we were trying to respect their culture, and males weren't even allowed to look at their females, much less search them. So even though we had entry control points coming, into the city, there was no way for us to, stop the flow of contraband coming into the city unless we searched the females. And we were trying to be respectful of the host nation, and we didn't search the females, so we had two choices: either search the females or stop allowing females in and out of the city. And I just took the tactics that we utilized in Africa and employed them in Iraq.
I personally know that we need them here, and I'm glad that they are here. I've personally been in firefights with at least 3 of them, and I was at the VBID with another 18 of them, and they all conducted themselves professionally. They're Marines. The bottom line, they're Marines. I really wish people would stop calling them female Marines, because they're Marines. That's what they are.
As the convoy was headed back out of the city towards ECP-1, a vehicle loaded with explosives and propane tanks swerved off of a side road and came barreling into the side of one of the 7-tons that happened to have a large number of female Marines and a couple sailors in that vehicle. And that created a huge explosion. The 7-ton truck was basically lifted up and flipped over onto its side, and Marines were pouring everywhere. And as soon as the explosion was done, they started coming under machine gun and sniper fire. So it was a coordinated attack. It wasn't an individual suicide bomber that was just part of the attack. The three that were killed in action on June 23rd, like I said, they were all volunteers. Two of them were Marines, one was a sailor. The sailor was Petty Officer First Class Regina Clark. She was kind of like the platoon bomb. She was older than me. She was a single mother. She was out of Washington. There was some significance with her, just because she was older, she was more mature, she was a reservist, she was a volunteer, and I had dinner with her the night before at the mayor's complex. So that one was a little tough. The two female Marines that were killed, they were both on their first enlistments. One of them was already planning to get out when her tour was done and use her GI Bill to go to college. And the other one was she was from a broken home in the Bronx, and she basically joined the Marine Corps to help support her mother and her family. And all three of them are recognized and memorialized in Arlington. There's a women's memorial that kind of goes through the span of time, you know, all the way back to the Civil War and the significant roles that females played in you know, the U.S. operations over time, whether it was, you know, the Revolutionary War or the Civil War, you know, all the way up to Iraq and Afghanistan. And I was able to go to Arlington this past January with one of my platoon sergeants that was with me that entire tour, and we were able to visit that site.